Hi, welcome back to Spider's Web. Today I'm getting to do an interview with a very dear friend of mine who is just such an incredibly talented and creative guy. He's a producer, he's a theater owner, and he's endless with creative ideas that have to do with the music industry and all sorts of facets of live performance. And I'm going to introduce you to Mr. David Fink. Hi, David.
Hi, Spider.
How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Oh, I'm thrilled. I'm thrilled. And so I'm going to start our conversation today because I met you, girl, what was it, a decade ago?
It was a long time ago.
At least a decade
Probably
ago.
Probably at least a decade.
And it was because David still owns a theater in Three Oaks, Michigan. Those of you who are not from the Chicago area, some of you may be from the Chicago area and don't know about Three Oaks because it's a beautiful sort of Lake Michigan playground area that is very, very charming, and it has lots of, you know, geographic beauty, and there's the lake, and it's like, you know, old-timey, sweet, artistic area. And David owns a theater called the Acorn Theater. So tell about how on earth did you do that, and about where the building came from.
Okay, I'll try to make this kind of quick.
But, hurry up, talk faster.
Okay, I had a partner, and we had a bed and breakfast in the area, because it's kind of, a lot of people go there for weekends from Chicago.
Oh, yeah.
Other side of the lake. It was really popular before air conditioning. And a lot of people from the art scene in Chicago have places out there. And so we had this bed and breakfast, and we decided to do a show, a live show of kind of creative, interesting performance, mostly from Chicago. And we sold out a bunch of shows and said, oh, there's an audience out here, we should do more. And that's what led to us buying this former corset factory.
How many people can say they bought a corset factory?
Not enough.
I think
Maybe
I've only
many.
Met one of you. Yeah, I think that's it.
It's from around the turn of the last century, and it was really decaying. It was in terrible shape.
I guess so.
And we're, you know, a big hole in the roof, and we're kind of out of our minds, but we bought the building, rehabbed it, and started doing shows. And our initial vision was to have maybe one or two person shows, Fridays and Saturdays only, $15 tickets, sell 100 tickets for each show, and that we'd make no money, but we'd cover our costs. And that was the model.
Wow.
But we found it was not easy to get 100 people twice a week.
Yeah.
And people didn't want to just see one person and two person shows. So organically it kind of developed, and we got a liquor license, we added more sound system and lights and sound and a bar, and it kind of grew and developed. And we now have a theater that seats about 270 people when packed.
Wow.
But it's got great sound. It's very kind of quirky and intimate and beautiful. And it feels very communal. When you're there, it feels like you're at a party, not just at a show.
Exactly. And the very first time I laid eyes on it, famed record producer Robin McBride gave me a ride over there on New Year's Eve day. I was actually playing New Year's Eve that night at a really glamorous old building called the Inn at Union Pier.
Yes.
And he brought me over to meet you, and your little dog was a puppy.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a little Sheltie, and she was literally, they had all these tables that were all sparkly and pretty, you know, all set up for New Year's. She was running in circles, hurting the tables, I guess. She ran around in circles, jumped up in my arms, and fell asleep.
Yep.
And I was like, oh, I love this place. There's a little dog. And then eventually I played there. I did several performances
right there.
One of them being an experimental project that was then called Entertaining Guests, that eventually mm-hmm. became my one-woman show called The Roar of the Butterfly. But also played there on occasions to do Cole Porter Celebration and different mm-hmm. stuff. And it was always such a pleasure to go to that town because there are all these like little towns that are around there, like Long Beach,
yeah.
and Union City,
Union Pier,
not Union City's in New Jersey. I forgot about that. But it was like, it was always so much fun to go there and to see what was going to be coming up next. Like you would have marquees out for different things that were coming. It was so eclectic.
Yeah, well, our philosophy was we're in a small town, so we have a lot of different things, so the same people can come over and over and over again, and not get bored. And we're not farther than the suburbs of Chicago, but it's completely different vibe than the suburbs. It's a little farm town with this great art scene. We have an art house movie theater in town that only shows indie films. We have a Music in the Park series with free concerts in the summer, which you're going to...
I'm going to be performing over performing this summer.
It's just, it's just this great little town.
You know, it reminds me of the theater and artsy places that are up in Long Island. It reminds me very much of Long Island.
Yeah, well, I say we're the Hamptons of Chicago.
Yes, exactly. That's it. Yeah, perfect. Yeah, you got something there. You got away with the word. No, but really, it is very much like the Hamptons. And there's like cute little antique stores and gift shops and, you know, a lot of artist galleries. And it's a very fun place to go any time of the year, but I guess summer is when it really thrives.
Yeah, I like winter when it's in the snow belt and it's quiet and all the restaurants have like $10 specials and it's just easy to do everything. It's very beautiful.
Let's go. I'm going now. Right.
No, we've got some celebrities up there, kind of like the Hamptons, but they're up there. They're not really celebrities. They're just, you know, neighbors and people.
Wow. Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. Who are some of the celebrities?
Joan Cusack has a house in Three Oaks, and when she's up there, she's just a mom. Yeah.
And my neighbor, Rahm Emanuel, has a house up there.
He does. For sure. Oprah, she sold her farm, but it was right outside Three Oaks. So she used to shop in Three Oaks all the time.
Oh, how cool.
And yeah, Roger Ebert used to come to the Acorn and blog about it. Carol Marin is up there. And actually, a lot of the news people from Chicago have places up there.
How fabulous.
Yeah.
So we're going to take a little musical break, and then we're going to talk more about the gossip of Three Oaks.
Sounds good.
I'll build a stairway to paradise with a new step every day. I'm going to get there at any price. Stand aside, I'm on my way. I've got the blues and up above it's so fair. Shoes go on and carry me there. I'll build a stairway to paradise with a new step every day.
Wasn't that something? You can't imagine what we were doing during that musical break. I don't even want to talk about it.
No,
it's no, it's too much. Too much personal information. But once again, we're listening to David Fink, who is the one of the owners and co-creators of the Acorn Theater in Three Oaks.
Yep.
And I just want to talk a little bit about how crazy this got. Like, how eclectic. Because every time I would come there, you would always tell me like, oh, well, next week we have something. And it would be like something so out of the range of what I do, like very eclectic, different, adventurous. And you must have had so much fun with some of the... Just tell a little bit about some of the entertainers you had there.
Well, we've had quite a variety of things, and I don't want to sound like I'm name-dropping because...
Oh, we love name-dropping. I'll name-drop. That's why people listen to this show.
I'll say some names, but just because somebody's famous doesn't mean that people that are less famous are less talented.
No, but it's pretty cool.
Great people that you might not have heard of that you should know.
Bingo.
That are just as good, if not better, than some of the famous people. But yeah, we do a real variety of things. And we had there's a guy named Bob Swan that brought an opera series to the Acorn. And so in this little intimate room, you have these great opera singers.
How cool.
And he does great stuff. And the most famous probably was Nathan Gunn, who did a concert. And he walked in, he said, your farthest seat here is where my conductor normally would stand. So everybody in the theater is closer than anybody.
It's like being on top of somebody.
He was so nervous. This is the closest I ever sang to a bar.
Oh, I love it. Did the dog come to the...
Because, the dog was there, yeah.
That's one of my favorite. I'm just going to interject this. Little Ennis, the dog that jumped up in my arms, she would come to the last part of my shows. They would let her come down, you know, into the theater, and she'd stand by the bar. And on my last number, she would usually go, ooh. She would kind of harmonize with whatever I was doing, which I loved the fact that you would do that. Now, that may not be for everyone, but I definitely adored it. But anyway, Nathan Gunn, and then give me some names of these people.
Well, Leslie Gore, who I think performed around when you were performing.
Yes, you were telling me she was coming, and that's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was amazing. What I loved about her, besides everything, was that she would sing her hits full out, beginning to end. She didn't just do a medley of her hits, but she actually sang them, which pleased the audience.
Oh.
And she might have been tired of them by that time, but she still did.
Well, the audience wasn't.
No, the audience, that's what they loved.
That's smart,
it. Let's see, we've had burlesque, we've had a bunch.
Oh, that's right, I remember that, okay.
A bunch of new musicals where we did anywhere from just readings to stage readings to stage readings were kind of on steroids.
The steroid readings.
So those are always fun. People get to see a work for the very first time and talk about it. We've had a number of plays, sometimes touring, sometimes we just bring them. In fact, there are a couple more that I'm planning on for this season, so we'll see.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. Cool.
So we'll see if those happen. Had, let's see, who else? Janice Siegel from Manhattan Transfer.
Who I adore.
Did a tribute to Ella.
Oh, wow.
Which was amazing. Had, speaking of Siegels, Corky Siegel comes regularly.
Not related,
but Corky's amazing.
I love Corky.
Comes with all sorts. He comes with his chamber blues, which is kind of classical mixed with blues. Comes with Howard Levy doing, they both play keyboards.
And
harmonica. And they're amazing.
My darling, I love him.
Musically, it's as good as it gets, and performance-wise. And then some more contemporary people like Sean Mullins or Cracker or Bodines or Poor Dog Pondering.
Wow.
Cowboy Junkies. In this little intimate space, it feels like a party with just world-class entertainment, and it's very cool.
It's amazing. I mean, like, some of these people I didn't even realize were there. This is, like, information for me, too.
Jeff Daniels has been there a couple times with his kids' band. I love people that support their artist children. And Jeff is a really, good songwriter, good musician, besides being a famous actor.
Wow.
And he's from Michigan, so it's
I did not cool. realize that.
Yeah, he's from Chelsea. He's been there to Acorn a couple times. Hopefully he'll be back.
Very groovy.
Yeah.
Wow, but the Acorn is, keeps going on. And then just tell a little bit of just about what it's like now, what you're currently doing right now. You have a format now that's kind of wide open.
Well, the Acorn, we lease the space to a not-for-profit.
Uh-huh.
And they are pretty much a rental house. So they have a programming committee that votes yes or no on whether people can do a show there based on their vision for what the theater is.
Yeah.
And so I'm one of many people that are renting the theater and doing shows. And I bring in mostly music, but sometimes plays and sometimes other things. But I've got some jazz coming, some blues, some rock, some pop. I still try to mix it up.
Excellent.
It's great. It's
fun. I'm glad there are people with that kind of mind like you that, is wide open.
But getting the talent is not as hard as getting people to come see them.
You bet, baby.
Bringing the American Idol people and they have an audience from TV, but... Broadway names don't necessarily pack the place.
And it may or may not. You just kind of don't know. But now all you pod listeners, I just gave you a new title, pod listeners, you will know about this now. And, it could even be part of, if you're coming to visit Chicago for the first time, it could be part of your destination to take a side trip out
there.
Yeah, very cool. Well, let's take another music break. Okay. And then we're going to do things that we're not going to tell you about now while you listen to some music. Sounds like a plan, doesn't it?
Yep.
Uh-huh. Wasn't that fun? Well, now, I still have... David Fink is still here.
Still here.
He hasn't left yet.
They're sick of me.
I don't know what we're going to have to say to get him to finish this interview. But anyway, we are going to talk a little bit about other projects that he has other than the Acorn Theater. And one of them is something else I'm going to be involved in. But this was a storytelling thing.
Yeah.
Tell about that, because I don't really know a lot about it. I know I'm going to be in it, but yeah. I talk about that.
Well, it's in its fourth year now. And
oh, I'm only 4 years behind the times.
No, it's okay. Yeah. It's LGBTQ true storytelling. Like, if you ever listen to Moth Radio, it's that style of personal narrative. And the format is we usually have 6 to 7 people that are LGBTQ that tell a personal story. But once a year, we now have a Friends and Ally show, and people tell story, friend or ally story. And it's great. People, the room is packed, and people love it. And you have a room of, in my mind, kind of literate introverts all gathering together.
That's great.
Sharing a space.
Yeah.
And it's really amazing.
And this takes place in Chicago.
In Chicago.
Yes.
And the audience is very diverse. So the storytellers are... diverse also, but pretty much, LGBTQ, but the audience is pretty much everything. And it's
how cool.
It's a great gathering. It's really fun and it's really impactful, and you will love it.
I will. I'm looking forward to that. And I'm doing that in November, right?
First Tuesday every month, so yeah, first Tuesday in November.
Meow.
And
cool.
And I also do some storytelling around town and other people's shows.
You do?
Yeah, I'm working on a story now that,
Tell me when that... Well, all right, well...
I don't have any gigs scheduled right now.
So we can't blab about it, but we'll keep an eye out for you. Do you have a website that's yours that we find these things out?
OutspokenChicago.com is the Outspoken Storytelling Show. I don't have a personal website.
Oh, yeah, Outspoken. Okay,
I have a Facebook page.
Got it.
David Fink Show's Facebook group where I post stuff that I'm doing.
Excellent. And then you have some other projects, too, in the works now, right?
Yeah, I'm on the board of a TV show called Big Questions, and the website is bqnow.com. It won a Midwest Emmy a couple years ago.
Wow.
And we're nominated for Emmys, and it's really cool. It's a documentary, little documentaries, kind of about ethical issues, and we go around the world and kind of present the issue and what people are trying to do to address it, but we don't really give solutions. Kind of leave that up to the audience to
figure it out. Somebody fix this.
This is what people are doing. You do something.
That's great, though.
Yeah, so if you go to bqnow.com, you can kind of get a taste of that.
Cool.
And it's fun and exciting. And with them, I got to travel to Tanzania and to Ghana.
Wow.
Yeah. So
that is very groovy.
Yeah.
I love it. You're endlessly creative. And, I mean, you're always involved in something new. And this interview has just been a delight because I knew you were a wealth of information, but this is a lot of projects going on. This is a very creative guy here. And also, David Fink and I were talking about this. One of our favorite interviewers and writers is Rick Kogan, who is our Chicago hero, who we absolutely adore. And anybody that's in the arts of any form has been interviewed by Rick Kogan. I mean, he's
the
best friend. Neck and neck with Studs Terkel, but far younger.
Baton.
Yeah, and we love Kogan so much. I really want to lobby to get Kogan as an interviewee on my podcast, which would be hilarious because he's always interviewing me, and I think he's just the best interviewer in the world. So I would be up to a big task there, but it would be exciting. And he's just so brilliant and so funny that we're lobbying right now to have him honored by the city of Chicago for all the things that he's done.
Secretly. He's not supposed to know about that.
Oh, oops, sorry. Rick, if you're listening, plug your ears in.
It's a secret thing.
That would be amazing.
It would. He deserves it. He's very humble, and so that's why it has to be secretive.
Meow, baby. Well, this is a place to keep a secret because I think I've got, 5 listeners out there? Anyway, we love all 5 of you here on Spider's Web. Please keep listening. Tell 3 of your best friends and we'll build an audience. Thank you, David Fink.
Thank you, Spider.
And thank you guys for listening. Yep. Come back again next week for more craziness.
Get in touch with that sundown fellow as he tiptoes across the sand. He's got a million kinds of stardust. Pick your favorite brand and dream when you're feeling blue. Dream, that's the thing to do. Just watch the smoke rings rising. Dream, and they might come true.